Hello everyone, my name is Miquel Farré, I'm a senior technology manager at Disney. I've been part of the engineering behind the magic for the last 8 years, and in my current role, I lead a distributed team of very skilled engineers and data scientists. We are all based across Europe, from Spain, Bulgaria, and Switzerland. I'm the one located in Switzerland. And today, I'm very excited to share with all of you a project that we started 6 years ago, the Creative Genome. Why did we start this project? Well, Disney has a broad and unique catalog. In that catalog, we can find different character universes. Within Disney's animated content, we can find different shooting styles, ambience, color gradings, and the same applies for live-action content. Basically, each creative work has its particular style. On top of this, we also have outstanding programming around sports and news produced every day. We noticed that creatives from different parts of the company spend hours searching for specific clips of content. This is because content search and retrieval is a challenging task. In fact, for the ones here that were consuming content in the 90s, making an analogy between those mixtapes that we used to do and content archiving, we see similar problems. Most of the times, our only reference to the content of the mixtape was the sticker on it, which does not give a very good visibility of what's inside. The same happens in media archives. Most of the metadata is at title level. And even this title level metadata can be ambiguous. The scope of the tag love songs in the tape will need to be properly defined and agreed on to make that tag useful, especially if we want to search across millions of tapes. Allow creatives navigate content archives and search for specific moments motivated the foundation of the Creative Genome. Today, this index of descriptive metadata is accessible to all creatives in the company. Animators can use it to find appearances of a character with a happy face or to remember how the body of the character articulates when it jumps. New members of our writing room can use Genome to get up to speed on what happened during the last seasons, identify if something already happened in the past, and be coherent with the story in new episodes. Our consumer-facing platforms can use Genome metadata in the recommendation engines. Marketing teams can quickly find moments using our index to create promotional content. And those are just a few examples of how Genome is being used. Let's take a look under the hood. Genome metadata is created combining manual tagging and automatic tagging that relies on machine learning models. Before working on a new model, the librarians that are part of Genome prepare the taxonomy that we will use. This is our way to clarify the scope of each of our machine learning models. The taxonomy defines which categories we should be able to distinguish with our model, keeping in mind the use cases that we want to cover. Once the taxonomy is defined, we communicate it to our team of taggers that will annotate manually part of our content. We use this manual tagging to create a machine learning model that we will end up deploying in production to continue the tagging. Done? Not yet. Our work is not done at this point. We have an active learning loop in place to trigger manual tagging QA and taxonomy adjustments. The manual QA is usually triggered to validate some challenging cases, and a taxonomy adjustment could be triggered by different reasons, based on performance. Maybe we don't need to differentiate between some categories that are causing problems. For example, we might not need to differentiate between a stairs and a staircase in our generic locations model. Another reason that will trigger a taxonomy adjustment is the appearance of new entities in the content. For example, a new character or new fictional location in our favorite show. By the way, model training relies on tools from the PyTorch ecosystem, MMF for multimodal architectures, and Optuna for hyperparameter search. Torch drift is one of the indicators that triggers the retraining of our models. Now let's focus on our inference pipeline. Given the volume and length of our content, we need to be highly efficient when we run inference across our archive. Our pipeline is end-to-end PyTorch based and it works that way. Given a video and its frames, we split the video in segments using the iframes as boundaries. The workers on the PyTorch data loader take care of loading the frames in batches. We process the batches to select content keyframes. The keyframes will go through the selected machine learning model. And as a last step, the results might be aggregated with the inference results of other frames. The key advantage of this pipeline is that we move the content once to GPU and all is processed there. And this is possible thanks to the PyTorch data loader and Cornea. Overall, following the genome model creation workflow, we have more than 270 machine learning models in production. Some of those are valid for any content, and we occasionally retrain them, but most of the models are tailored to a specific franchise or series. We have all kinds of models. We can tag activities, events, fictional locations as well as generic locations, characters between others. Working on Disney's universe is particularly challenging. Let's take character recognition as an example. As you can see, the appearance of our heroes can be quite different in live action, comics, or animation. And on top of that, the appearance of the content also changes in different stages of production. Continuing with challenging examples, another case is the recognition of activities and events. The nature of those activities and events are different than the ones in academic datasets. For example, our activities and events taxonomy include terms like apology, lothing, or babysitting. Given the taxonomy in our scope, it was a natural fit to think in multimodality for this problem. Using PyTorch's multimodal framework, we pass an image sequence, closed captioning, and audio information through custom encoders, and afterwards we fusion the output of the encoders to infer a result. This is currently work in progress, and we are experimenting in the fusion layers with transformers as well as feature concatenation. Another problem that we solve with multimodality is content scene splitting. We define a scene as a collection of shots semantically connected by the characters that appear, the topic, and the location. In this first example, we can see very different shots that an only video-based model could understand as different scenes, but the continuity in the audio signal helps us identify it as the same scene. In the second example, the audio signal helps us in the opposite, to identify that the boundary between shots is in fact a change of scene. Well, I hope you enjoyed this preview of Genome. I don't want to conclude before giving credit to Monica, Albert, Jordi, Cesc, Marc, Pablo, and Marcel, the fantastic team behind the machine learning workflow and the models that you saw. And if you wonder how we could go so far with such a small team, well, we owe part of the efficiency to the PyTorch community. On screen, you can see the ecosystem tools that we are using in production and some of the ones that we are currently experimenting with. We had the chance to meet some of the talented people behind those projects, and we also had the opportunity to discuss and share ideas with other individuals in the PyTorch community, like Robert Munro, author of the book Human in the Loop Machine Learning, and the Facebook AI Partner Engineering Team. This is definitely a good place to thank you for your help. Thank you. We will all agree that machine learning is an exciting area to be working on. It is moving at a high pace, and we see in PyTorch and its ecosystem a fantastic technology stack and group of people to experiment together, share knowledge, and move fast. We look forward to meeting you and discuss together. Thank you for watching. Thank you.